Earth could not have been created in 6 days, that it took thousands, if not millions, of years of geological changes, of atmospheric changes, of biological changes. So to him, the evidence was everywhere. There was no question about the way the Earth had evolved. It evolved the same way a human being evolves.
Drawing together all these threads, it seems to me that the Mona Lisa provides us with a snapshot of the mature Leonardo's mind, a distillation of all that he had discovered through a lifetime's observation into the secrets of nature.
All his life, Leonardo had wanted to control nature. He mapped town and countryside, planned to subdue and divert great rivers. He cut through mountains, built bridges, all to rearrange and order God's creation.
But order had its flip side in disorder and chaos. Leonardo knew that nature could be both unpredictable and terrifying.
It strikes me as it's a very unstable picture, towering mountains, and they look like they might fall down, tumble down any time.
Unease about the picture.
It's undergoing the biggest cataclysmic changes imaginable.
The River Arno has always been unpredictable and subject to often devastating floods. As recently as the 1960s, it caused terrible destruction to buildings and works of art in Florence. Leonardo himself had witnessed as a child one of the worst of all deluges, one he recalls years later.
The air was darkened by the heavy rain driven aslant by the crosswinds. The fire rent and tore the clouds asunder. What fearful noises were heard through the dark air as thunder violently shot through it to strike anything that lay in its course. What weeping and wailing as terrified beings flung themselves into the waters. How many mothers wept for their dead children, their arms raised to heaven as the hills collapse into the depths of a flooded valley.
Leonardo even produces a record of the aftermath. Furniture, books, the detritus of everyday life heaped up after the terrible flood subsided.
The deluge drawings are, in a sense, the ultimate reflection of this idea that there is a superior force. And these are vast forces, and what happens in the human heart, what happens in the mind, are all little microcosmic reflections of these vast forces. So it's a complete spectrum. And towards the end of his life, there are these amazing visions where there is an insight that however much you understand the forces, there is an awesome dimension which is outside human ability to control.
The presence that rose thus so strangely beside the waters is expressive of what, in the ways of a thousand years, men had come to desire. She is older than the rocks among which she sits. Like the vampire, she's been dead many times and learned the secrets of the grave. What was the relationship of a living Florentine to this creature of his thought? By what strange affinities had the dream and the person grown up thus apart, and yet so closely together?
Leonardo never delivered the portrait of Lisa del Giocondo. He carried it with him wherever he went for the last 16 years of his life, even into exile.
At the age of 61, Leonardo left Italy, never to return. Younger and more fashionable artists like Raphael and Michelangelo were now flavor of the month and regularly gaining the most glamorous commissions.
This is where his journey ended, at the French town of Amboise in the Loire Valley. If Leonardo was underappreciated in his homeland, he was certainly welcomed by the French king. Francis I was determined to import the glories of a Renaissance. In recognition of Leonardo's unique status, he gave him a large manor house right next door to the royal castle. Leonardo's last years were not easy. He suffered a stroke, which meant he lost the use of his right hand. But his increasing infirmity didn't seem to matter to the young French king, who treasured every moment he was able to spend with such a wise old man.
Many believe that this tunnel in Leonardo's house was directly connected to the royal castle in Amboise, and that Francis I used it to visit Leonardo at night. They would talk through the night, the old man and the young king. So at last, towards the end of his life, Leonardo, so often misunderstood and taken for granted, had found a patron who really understood the nature of his genius.
In his last years, Leonardo tried to pull together thousands of pages of notes and drawings into a grand encyclopedia. But the task of compiling the observations of a lifetime, like so many of his ambitious schemes, remained unfinished.
While I thought I was learning how to live, I've really been learning how to die. As a day well spent brings happy sleep, so a life well used brings contented death.
Leonardo died here in his room in Clos-Lus on the 2nd of May, 1519. He was 67 years old.
He's said to have died in the arms of the French king. This is how the painter Ingres imagined the scene 300 years later. The great architect Benvenuto Cellini, who also served Francis I, wrote this.
I have to record the words the king spoke to me, that he believed there had never been another man born in the world who knew as much as Leonardo. Not so much about painting, sculpture, and architecture, as that he was a very great philosopher.
It's taken 500 years for many of Leonardo's ideas to become a reality. Even now, we can only begin to understand the sheer scale of his achievements. When he began his restless journey through life, the painter was regarded as little more than a lowly craftsman. Leonardo changed all that. And in this one painting, the Mona Lisa, all the passions and preoccupations of a lifetime come together. The Mona Lisa is the first great psychological portrait. It's Leonardo's attempt to capture the energy, the essence of life itself. It's not a mystery that's easily resolved, but he's caught an instant and an eternity. Like a magician, he's made the invisible visible.
Don't pity the humble painter. He can be lord of all things, whatever exists in the universe. He has first in his mind, and then in his hand. By his art, he may be called the grandchild of God.
Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa, men have named you. You're so like the lady with the mystic smile. Is it only 'cause you're lonely they had blamed you for that Mona Lisa strangeness in your smile? Do you smile to tempt a lover, Mona Lisa? Or is this your way to hide a broken heart?